Good morning and welcome to our Sunday morning service at Ainsdale Evangelical. We pray that you all are well. I'm going to start off with a psalm, please.
Yeah. It's Psalm 46 and it's titled, God, the Refuge of His People. I'm going to read verses 1 to 7. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore we will not fear, though the earth should change, and though the mountains slip into the heart of the sea. Though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains quake and its swelling pride. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy dwelling places of the Most High. God is in the midst of her, she will not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations made an uproar, the kingdoms tottered. He raised his voice and the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
Amen. And our first song will be All the Way My Saviour Leads Me. Us as we sing and play melodies to you, and we ask for a blessing upon Greg as he brings your message in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen. And for the next song is Crown Him with Many Crowns. And for our next song is Just As I Am. Apply your message to our lives, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning, everyone. I can't see you all this morning, but I hope you'll bear with having to look at my face this morning. Let's come before the Lord, shall we, and pray. Father God, we thank you for this time, Lord, that we can gather together around your word, Lord, and we know that your word is true, because the Lord Jesus told us, he said, sanctify us, sanctify them in your word. Your word is truth, Father. And we confess that this morning, Lord, that your word is true, and that the Lord Jesus Christ, you are faithful and true. And you've redeemed us from the curse by shedding your blood on that accursed cross, Lord. We just thank you and praise you this morning. And we ask that you would be with us, bless us, and open our ears and our eyes and give us understanding of your word this morning, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Right, well, I was going to look at Hebrews chapter 4 this morning, but I was thinking about it last night, and I thought that this message might be more appropriate for these times. So we're going to look at Mark chapter 4 this morning. So I'm going to begin in verse 35 and read till the end of the chapter. It says, "On the same day, when evening had come, he said to them, 'Let us cross over to the other side.' Now when they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat as he was, and the other little boats were also with him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that it was already filling. But he was in the stern," that's the back of the ship, "asleep on a pillow. And they awoke him and said to him, 'Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?' Then he arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, 'Peace, be still.' And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. But he said to them, 'Why are you so fearful? And how is it that you have no faith?' And they feared exceedingly and said to one another, 'Who can this be that even the wind and the sea obey him?'" So first of all, we see that this is an awesome display of the Lord's power. He just spoke into the air. The waves ceased, the wind ceased, and they were safe. They would have drowned, no doubt, without the Lord's interference. And he just spoke, and everything became calm. And we need that these days in our lives, don't we? We need the Lord to speak. And through his mighty power and his word, he will calm the waves and the storm in our life. Because let's face it, we're all in a storm in this day and age, aren't we? We can't escape it. When we hear about it, we're drip fed it every second of the day on the news, if we listen. Okay, so the disciples were out doing the Lord's will. They'd been preaching and teaching in the land around, and they were crossing over the sea, and this great storm broke out. So it's reminiscent, I think, of Jonah chapter 1. Let's look at that for a contrast, shall we? "Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, 'Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me.' But Jonah arose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. But the Lord sent out a great wind on the sea, and there was a mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship was about to be broken up. Then the mariners were afraid, and every man cried out to his God and threw the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten the load. But Jonah had gone down into the lowest parts of the ship and lain down and was fast asleep. So the captain came to him and said to him, 'What do you mean, sleeper? Arise, call on your God. Perhaps your God will consider us, so that we may not perish.' And they said one to another, 'Come, let us cast lots, that we may know for whose cause this trouble has come upon us.' So they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. For then they said to him, 'Please tell us, for whose cause is this trouble upon us? What is your occupation, and where do you come from? Where is your country, and of what people are you?' So he said to them, 'I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land.' Then the men were exceedingly afraid and said to him, 'Why have you done this?' For the men knew that he fled from the presence of the Lord, because he had told them. Then they said to him, 'What shall we do to you, that the sea may be calm for us?' For the sea was growing more tempestuous. And he said to them, 'Pick me up and throw me in the sea, and the sea will become calm for you. For I know that this great tempest is because of me.' Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to return to land, but they could not, for the sea continued to grow more tempestuous against them. Therefore they cried out to the Lord and said, 'We pray, O Lord, please do not let us perish for this man's life, and do not charge us with innocent blood. For you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you.' So they picked up Jonah and threw him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. And the men feared the Lord exceedingly and offered a sacrifice to the Lord and took vows. So we see there are some similarities, aren't there? And the first one is there was a fear of death. These men were in fear of their lives in both situations. In Mark 38, they woke Jesus. They said, "Teacher, are you not concerned that we're perishing?" They knew they were about to die and they were scared. And at the end of Jonah there, we see that the captain came to him, woke him up and said, "You know, what are you doing? We're about to die here. You need to get up and call on your God." And you've got to admire the pragmatism of this guy, haven't you? You know, he knows there's a God out there. He's not sure which one it is. But he says, "Look, everyone, call on your God. I don't care who they are. Maybe one of them is the right one. And that God will save us." Well, of course, that the right God was Jonah's God. But the point there is fear. They were all terrified. And fear leads to action, doesn't it? I think back when I got saved, I was reading a lot about biblical prophecy and I was reading about the day of the Lord. And I was terrified, to be honest. The fear of the Lord was in me because I'd read about all these catastrophes that were going to come at the end of the world. And I could see that the world was lining up with all this. I could see that all these nations were aligned against Israel. And I could see that Israel really was the focal point of this story that this God was telling me. And I reasoned in my mind, I said, this book was written thousands of years ago by people who couldn't possibly know or influence the future. How is it that these world events have come together to agree with what this ancient book says? And I reasoned that it must be true. And because of that, I knew there was a God. I knew he told me what was going to happen. And I knew that if I didn't get right with him, that I was going to be destroyed in this coming day of the Lord. And I was terrified. And that fear for me was a great motivator. And we see it in these two situations. Fear motivated these men into action in both times. And this is something that I feel we can use in this day and age. People are scared out there. They've every right to be. And it's not a surprising thing when you look at the fear that's being pumped across the media spectrum. And I always think that when the left-wing media and the right-wing media agree, that's when you really need to be concerned, because usually these guys are fighting each other tooth and nail. They're going at it. They're completely ideologically opposed, so you would think. But I believe that the people who are above them pulling the strings, although they may pretend to be ideologically opposed, really, secretly, they're in the same secret clubs, the Skull and Bones and the Freemasons and the Rosicrucians and all these occult secret societies. And at the top, they agree. So when these media giants come together and agree and say, "You must be very scared, or you must agree this, you must believe this, or you're a denier or a heretic," or whatever the case may be, then it's time to sit up and say, "Well, what's really going on?" But because of that, because of all the media storm, people are scared. And they should be scared as well, because really we're coming closer and closer until the day of the Lord. And, you know, really we don't know how dangerous this virus is. It seems to some people it's very dangerous. It may not be quite as dangerous if you've got the right treatment, which, I hasten to add, you're probably not going to get in the NHS or in, you know, the government-sponsored hospitals, because they don't understand or believe in the correct treatments that we're hearing about. So can we use this fear that people have got to motivate them into reading the scriptures and to reading what Jesus says and to read what the Lord is telling us about the world and all these things that are going to come about? So that's the first similarity. A second similarity we've got in these situations, obviously, is the storm. Now in Jonah, the Lord brought the storm. And in Mark, it's unspecified. It doesn't say who brought the storm. Is it the Lord? Is it Satan? Now, it could be that it's Satan in this case, but I hasten to add that, of course, God is sovereign. And we see in the Bible where the enemy intends to bring evil. It's only that God allows it that he's able to exercise his power, because he does have great power. He's called the Prince of the Power of the Air in Ephesians 2:2. That's an interesting phrase, isn't it? He's the Prince of the Power of the Air. So does he have some level of control or influence, or potentially some control or influence over the wind? I think it's possible that he does. If we look in Job 1:18-19, it says, "While he was yet speaking, another also came and said, 'Your sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house. And suddenly a great wind came from across the wilderness and struck the four corners of the house, and they are dead.'" And this, of course, is after Satan had complained to the Lord. The Lord had said to him, "Have you considered my servant Job, how he's righteous and upright, and there's no one like him in all the world?" And Satan said to him, "Well, I'm not surprised, because you've put a hedge around him and you've protected all his worldly goods. If you take away your hedge and take away his goods, he will curse you and die." So God took away his protection. He said, "Do them as you will, but preserve his life." And this is one of the consequences that Satan brought, that he brought about this great wind and it killed a lot of Job's children. So the conclusion is that Satan is able to cause great disaster in the world. But the caveat is, if the Lord allows it. The Lord is sovereign. The Lord is in control. And it's only if he restrains his hand and allows Satan, his malevolent influence, into the world, that he has this power to do so. And because the Lord is good, he doesn't allow him to do this all the time. And when he's doing it, he's the Lord is seeking to use it for his good. So someone today has brought a great storm upon us, haven't they? We're not able to meet on a Sunday. We're not able to meet on a Wednesday. We're all cooped up in our own houses. We can't go outside. We can't get the vitamin D that we desperately need from the sun, and we so rarely get in this country, because we're all confined to barracks. But we have to get on with that. So who has brought this storm against us? When we look at it, we see Bill Gates' involvement. We see this event 201 just before all this disaster happened. And we see that there was planning and foresight and consideration of what would happen if there was a coronavirus event released into the world. And we see, of course, Bill Gates has links to the Rockefellers. They have, of course, they have the statue of Prometheus outside the Rockefeller Center in New York. So we see what type of people they are. Prometheus, of course, is, what would you say, is a cult symbolism, essentially, for Satan. He is an allegory or a metaphor, would you say? He's a hidden language. He's the one who stole fire, they say, from the gods, gave it to mankind, and because of that, he rebelled against the gods, and he was cast down to the earth. Well, of course, that's the story of Satan wrapped up, isn't it? And obscured, so you can't see it as clearly as it is, because the occultists would tell us that Lucifer was the light bearer, and he brought us all the light of knowledge, which was, of course, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, which, of course, was an absolute disaster for mankind. But they are the friend of this Prometheus, this Lucifer. And so they see him as the good guy. They see the God of the Bible, the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, as the bad guy. They see him as a malevolent bully, as Richard Dawkins would say, and someone who kept mankind in the dark and Lucifer has liberated them. So this is who these people are. So these are the people who are intimately involved with this thing. So it's my conclusion, really, that this is the work of the enemy. The enemy has brought this about. And what are the effects of it? Well, the effects, of course, are economic. We've got an economic disaster, I believe, around the corner. When it comes, we don't know. It seems to me it'll be much bigger than 2008, because nobody took this amount of time off work in 2008. We didn't stop production and consumption in 2008. There was a big slowdown. There was sand in the gears, so to speak, and a freezing of markets. But nothing on this scale. So the economic effects are going to be big. Do what you can to prepare. And civil liberties probably will suffer. We've all been locked up now. There are people in the media saying that this is going to happen again. Melinda Gates was saying this is not a once in a lifetime occurrence. So they may plan to do this again in the future. And another effect, have we had more time with the Lord? We've all got more time on our hands now, because we don't need to commute. Some of us don't need to go to work. So have we had more time with the Lord? Is that one of the effects? So I think I think the one who's brought this storm against us is Satan. But as it says in Genesis, when Joseph was with his brothers, his their brothers fell upon their face and said to him, you know, don't hold us against this. And he said to them, essentially, you've meant this for evil, but the Lord has meant it for good. So the Lord used the famine, didn't he, in Egypt for their good. He brought them down to Egypt. Joseph preserved their lives. And Joseph said that the Lord was going to use this to save many lives. Well, I think the Lord indeed can use this, even if the enemy has brought it, to save many lives. So we see the two types of storms. One, from the enemy. And God is able to use it for his glory. He's well able, more than able, because he can wake people up. We see in Jonah, these people became petrified. These people were absolutely petrified and in fear of their lives. And God used that. If we look at the end of the chapter, it says, then the men feared the Lord exceedingly and offered a sacrifice to the Lord and took vows. Because of that fear, they came to know the Lord and they trusted in him. And they believed in him. And God is able to do the same today in this day and age. And I think we have a good opportunity as Christians, because we've known for many years. We've been able to prepare for many years, mentally, psychologically, spiritually, for this type of event. Because we know that all these troubles are coming upon the earth. So we've got a head start effectively on the rest of society. I was reading about stuff like this maybe 8 or 9 years ago, and I knew the type of person that Bill Gates was, so this is no surprise to me whatsoever to see this guy coming out. And now I've got people, friends of mine who are not Christians, not believers, sending me videos, people who weeks back were saying that Jesus never existed, it's all a myth, it's a fable, it's a legend. Those same people are now sending me videos saying, do you think Bill Gates might be the Antichrist? And do you think this might be the mark of the beast? Well, like I say, God is well able to use this for his glory. What an opportunity this is. You've got people who previously wouldn't speak to you about the Lord, laughed it off, are now saying, what's going on? What's happening? Granted, some people are still asleep in the boat, so to speak. But a lot of people are waking up, multiple people who I've been trying to speak to for years about all this kind of stuff are now sending me videos and saying, what about this? What about this? What about this? And you know, it's become a daily occurrence. There are people out there who are looking for the truth. And when I came to find Jesus Christ, I wasn't looking for him. I was looking for the truth. But fortunately for me, two things. One, he was looking for me. And secondly, he is the truth. So when I really looked for the truth, I found him. And he is much better than the truth of what's going on in the world, the conspiracy theories, you know, the agendas of all these occult secret societies. To find him is like precious gold and diamonds and all the riches of the world. He is better. So that's the first type of storm from the enemy. God is able to use it. But the second type of storm we see in Jonah, which the Lord himself has brought, not the enemy. And that is designed to draw us back to him. And the question I've got is, has this storm drawn you back to him? Have you realised how weak and fragile we are, how that we are like a small boat tossed in the sea, and we need his protection? We need his guidance. And we need his help. And my other question is, have we used this time for him? We've got more time, I feel. Have we frittered away the time? Have we wasted the time, or have we used it for his glory? Or have we spent 3 hours a day on YouTube looking for information about coronavirus, which I must admit, I hold my hands up. I've been guilty of that. I've since stopped watching stuff about coronavirus because I feel it's a big distraction. And when I look at the media and the things that are coming down the pike, I think that this coronavirus thing is partly a big distraction from the agendas that are going on and are at play in the background, and they are seeking to curtail our civil liberties, shut down freedom of speech. There are loads of videos being censored because people are talking about coronavirus and the technology which is seeking to be implemented. All these sorts of videos are being banned. They're being pulled off YouTube. So what we're seeing is a lessening, a reduction of freedom of speech. Now, it's no concern of mine, frankly, if David Icke wants to go around talking about the lizard people. I don't agree with him about the lizard people, but I would defend his right to talk about that kind of thing because we need freedom of speech. We as Christians absolutely need freedom of speech. And these guys are seeking to curtail it, and they're shutting down YouTube. Okay, there are other platforms out there. There are BitChute and other things. I'm not an expert on other platforms, but they do exist. But the problem is that YouTube is the one that everyone knows. YouTube is the big marketplace, so to speak, where everyone goes and they know that they can tune in there and they can get some information. I've noticed, I used to watch stuff years ago on YouTube, and I noticed the recommendations were better, and it was much, much easier to find stuff on YouTube, stuff that was alternative, that was outside of the mainstream. Now it's becoming much more difficult because they're changing the algorithms. And they're locking it down and they're directing you towards their version of the truth. Now there's truth and there's someone's version of the truth, isn't there? There's events that actually happened. And then there's what the powers that be would want you to believe. And I found that often the two don't coincide. So there's a big problem with civil liberties here. But my question is, have we spent this time wisely? Or have we spent multiple hours a day on YouTube looking for coronavirus stuff? I advise all of us to get off YouTube, not get off YouTube entirely, but stop looking at the coronavirus stuff, because you just don't know. I mean, I think they're very much over egging the pudding. I think it's far less dangerous than they're admitting. It does seem to be dangerous for some people. And it's sensible to take precautions, and we need to obey the law, essentially. But it's not a productive use of time for us as Christians to be looking at 3 hours of coronavirus stuff a day. And that's my first warning for us, is the danger of being a consumer. Christians should be producers, essentially, not consumers. If anyone's familiar with networking, there's a thing in a network, a computer network, which is called a repeater. And I'll read you the definition of what a repeater is. A repeater is a device that receives a signal and transmits it. Repeaters are used to extend transmission over long distances or around obstacles. And to me, that's a good example of what a Christian should be. We receive a signal, don't we, from the Lord, essentially. And I would remind you, if you're not reading your Bible, if you're on YouTube for 3 hours, you're not reading your Bible, you're not receiving the signal that you should be receiving. And if you're not receiving that signal, how are you going to transmit it out there? But this is how the Lord uses Christians as repeaters. We hear the gospel, don't we? We repeat it to others. It says in Romans, doesn't it? How will they hear unless they have a preacher? We're called to be repeaters. And it says a repeater extends transmission over long distances or around obstructions. And there are lots of obstructions in this day and age, aren't there? Multiple obstructions, evolution, and you know, we could name millions of them, I'm sure. Obstructions to biblical Christianity. We need to get around those, and we need to be using this time to do that. We need to think, because we've got a big obstruction, haven't we, in that we can't go out and speak to people. So I want you to think, how are we going to communicate the gospel to people if we can't go out? We don't know how long this is going to last for. Could be a month, could be 6 months. And we still need to reach people. We still have a commission. We still need to be repeaters. We still need to receive the signal from the Lord and transmit it out there. How are we going to do that? How are we going to get around those obstructions? Second warning. There's loads of good stuff on YouTube. A lot of good stuff. Let me tell you, I've learned a lot from watching YouTube videos. But the warning there is, the more you learn, the more you're going to be on the hook for. And that is not an admission to stop learning, but to do something with it. My warning is, the scripture says, to whom much is given, from whom much is required. So if you've gone on YouTube and you've learned all this stuff that's going on in the world, you have a responsibility now to get on there yourself, or to get out there yourself and tell people what you know, to be a repeater. Don't be stuck as a consumer. Remember, we're called to be repeaters. We're called to repeat the gospel and get around those obstructions. How are we going to do that? A lot of people are seeing the agendas that are going on at play now. And we can use that. We can use that to get around those obstructions, because I find these days it's difficult to speak to people about Jesus, difficult to speak to people about the Bible. But if you can form common ground with them, if you can tell them, look, I know about this vaccination stuff. Mandatory vaccinations they're talking about now. They're talking about tracking people. They're talking about ID 2020, which is a UN objective. Well, we know about this as Christians, don't we? We call it the mark of the beast. So how do we speak to those people? Look, this is like, have you read in the Bible, in the book of Revelation, have you read about this mark of the beast where no man can buy or sell without this mark? It sounds a lot like that. How do we get around those objections? And third warning I have is, are we in danger of becoming a holy huddle? Are we in danger of speaking Christian language all the time to Christians? Have we become too inward focused as a church? And how do we get out of that? It's discouraging, isn't it, when we go and speak to people. speak to people on the street, and oh yes, yes, Jesus, that's nice, that's all well and good for you, I'm very happy for you, however, I've got to go to the butcher's or the baker's, or I'm going to Southport for a nice day out with my friends. We need to break out of our circle, effectively. We need to use different language and interact with the people around us. I feel now in a different way. And my question is, how do we do that? I'm sure we all have ideas. We need to think about that. We need to pray about that. I think, how does the Lord want to use us to wake people up? Because people need waking up, don't they? Jonah was sleeping in the boat. And the question is, are we sleeping in the boat? Have we become comfortable in our boat? Because it's nice, isn't it, to go to church. You meet with all the believers and everyone's clean. And, you know, they've been washed. And believers are good to spend time with. Because you feel good, you know, you build each other up and you feel great. But is there the danger that we could become too introverted and we forget about the world? We don't forget about them. Maybe we pray the Lord will bring them in, but we're not effective at bringing them in ourselves because we're speaking language that they don't understand, they don't relate to. And I'm seeing a number of people on YouTube now are doing stuff where they're talking all about the Illuminati, all this kind of stuff that people are fascinated in, people are interested in, and they are using it at the end to do a great gospel presentation. Because the dangers of giving someone a sermon and saying, well, this is a great sermon about such and such, if someone's not a Christian, they don't respect Christians, they won't listen to a sermon. So there's a real danger there that we can become too introverted. And I'm wondering, is the Lord going to use this storm to really shake us up and get us to think about how we impact the wider world around us and our town around us? And I feel it's useful for us to think on that and pray about it. So we're done with our similarities. I want to look at the difference now in these two stories between Mark and Jonah. And the biggest difference is, where was the Lord? In Jonah, the Lord was far off, far, far away. And Jonah was far from him. And the Lord wanted to use the storm to bring Jonah back into his will. Because Jonah was a believer, wasn't he? He was a prophet of God. But he wasn't doing what the Lord wanted. And the question is, are we going through the motions? Are we really pleasing God with what we're doing? Or is the Lord going to use this to bring us back to himself, into his will, rather? Because it's easy for us to be Christians and go along to church and listen to the sermon and pray and worship the Lord. And it can be very comfortable. And it can be difficult for us to get out of our comfort zone sometimes, can't it? Because the more we speak to people and the more they reject the message, we can become disheartened, I feel. Because the gospel's a wonderful thing, isn't it? And it's the Bible is a logical thing, really. It's logical that God exists. And it's logical that he's just and he must punish sin. It's logical that he's loving. And because of that, you get the gospel, don't you? That God sent his son to die on the cross because he must punish sin. But because he's loving and he wants to forgive us. So it is a logical thing when you get your head around it. You wrap your head around it and you really think about it. So it can be frustrating when we speak to people and they don't understand where we're coming from or they reject the message. So we can become insular. So the question is, are we doing really what God wants? Or are we, you know, 60 70% there, and there's that bit lacking that God is not really pleased about and God wants to change. So God used that to bring Jonah back into his will. But of course, in the other storm, in Mark, where was the Lord? Well, he was with them, wasn't he? He was in the boat with them. They were terrified. They thought that they were going to perish. But Jesus was with them. And he's with us, isn't he? He said, I'll never leave you, I'll never forsake you. And it's interesting to think, isn't it, that he was asleep. And I wonder, yes, he was asleep physically, but did he know what was going on? I think he probably did. It says the Lord neither slumbers nor sleeps, does it? Of course, Jesus had to sleep in his humanity. But in his deity and in his spirit, I believe that he knew what was going on. And he was in the boat with them. And they were terrified. But Jesus was there. He was with them. He's with us. We have no need to fear. And what was it he said? He said, why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? So we see that the opposite of fear is faith. And as Christians, we needn't have fear. We needn't fear coronavirus or the government response to it. I'm slightly more concerned about the government response than the virus personally. But we needn't fear it. We should trust in him. Look to him and remember his awesome power. In Mark 4:41, they said, who can this be that even the wind and sea obey him? And he has all things in his hand. He knows all about this. He knew about this from the beginning. And I feel he wants to use this storm to shake up the boat of our church, to motivate us to go out and speak to the people who have been stirred up, who are living in fear. How we do that as yet is unclear. We can make YouTube videos, we can always witness to people on the phone, on WhatsApp, all this kind of stuff. We can use this technology for the Lord's glory. I just feel that the Lord is using this time to shake us up. And if we haven't been shaken up, if we have been relaxing, if we've been, you know, spending too much time on YouTube, learning all these things, maybe cut it back. Maybe get up a bit earlier. Cut back on your YouTube usage. And certainly be circumspect about what you're sending to other people. Because if everyone's sending, you know, there's an hour, there's an hour, there's an hour, there's an hour. We're in danger of using up a lot of the time that the Lord has given us that we could devote to reading his scripture, to prayer, to witnessing to other people. So let's use this time wisely. Let's remember his awesome power. Like they said, who is this man who even the wind and waves obey? But let's remember that the Lord was in the boat with the disciples. He's in the boat with us because he loves us. He knows all of our fears and our difficulties. But he's in the boat with us. He didn't get out. He didn't walk across the sea as he could have done. He simply spoke into the air. He said, peace, be still, be calm. It all calmed down. And the day is coming when, of course, that sea will be calm forever. Well, actually, there'll be no more sea in the future, will there? When he comes and sets all things right. But before then, the sea could get a lot more choppy. And we need to carry on. We need to do what we should be doing. More of what we should be doing, in fact. We need to listen to him. We need to talk to him. We need to remember his great care for us and his awesome power and how he loves us, that he died for us on the cross, but that he wants to draw us back closer and closer to himself. And it says in his word, draw near to God and he will draw near to you. But sometimes if we forget to draw near to him, if we're lax about it, he will allow a storm to come that we will remember how fragile we are, how fragile our boats are, if you want to say that, and that we need him and we need to draw close to him. So the Lord bless you. Amen.
And for our last song is Before the Throne of God Above. That Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the message from Greg, and Lord, that we apply it to our lives. That Heavenly Father, until we meet again face to face, Lord, we ask for your protection around us, Lord, that you lift us up to your throne room, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.